staff was good enough to list for me all the exemptions and exceptions that this fine subcommittee and committee have made in the past, from the standpoint of Virginia State Fair, Jiffy Lube Live, an unknown amphitheater in the city of Alexandria, the Virginia International Raceway in Halifax County, the Richmond International Raceway here in the fine holy city of Richmond, Martinsville Speedway, multiple other performing arts locations, location in Norfolk, the National in Richmond, which is just up the street, a facility in Waynesboro, which is the historic Wayne Theater that Delegate Dickie Bell had, similar legislation to mine that did that, and then a unknown performing arts facility in the city of Harrisonburg. I believe that's the theater downtown. So, Mr. Chairman, I'm just trying to allow the town of Bridgewater the same authority that you granted prior to session.
Thank you, Delegate Lance. Do we have any questions from the committee at this time? Okay. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this?
Okay. Mr. Lisk will be here.
Well, I saw him. He didn't walk up immediately. So I assume, Mr. Lisk, you maybe voice some concerns.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Tom Lisk, representing the Virginia Restaurant Lodging Travel Association. And with great trepidation, I must stand up and raise a concern with the Vice Chairman of Appropriations Bill. we recognize from a community standpoint there might be value in this, but from a restaurant association standpoint, we just see this as one more carve-out, allowing an exception to an establishment to have the privilege to sell alcohol without the corresponding responsibility to serve food. But we do recognize that there are many carve-outs like this. This entity could obtain a one-day banquet special events license. They could get one 365 times throughout the year. So this would allow them to get one license for the year. But because there's no food requirement, we have to be true to our principles and say, as long as restaurants are required to sell food, we think that there should be an obligation for others who want the privilege to sell alcohol to also sell food. And I certainly have to entertain any questions.
Okay. Any questions, Mr. List? Okay. Anyone on the committee have any questions, concerns, discussion? Okay. Chair, I'll entertain a motion. Motion and second discussion. All in favor? We'll cast your vote on the electronic voting board. Okay. Looks like on a vote of 7-0 moves forward. And I don't believe that you'll have to come to full committee. If you do, we'll notify you.
I appreciate it, Mr. Chairman. I do appreciate the subcommittee's time and consideration.
The next one is House Bill 1650, Delegate Ware.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There's a minor technical amendment that needs to be added. The staff has that.
Substitute. Okay, we'll get the substitute before us here so we can look at it for a second and we'll hold off. We do have a motion and a second and a substitute. Okay, Billy Blair, or maybe Jessica, could you tell us what's different from the original piece of legislation and the substitute?
Mr. Chairman, what's different about the original bill and the substitute is a simple change in the new section that was added. Originally, we had it listed as the director making the call on whether or not, or allowing someone to be anonymous, and according to the Virginia Lottery, it should be the department instead of the director. And the only other change is I moved it to a whole different section because the original section was listed under powers of the director. So it no longer applied in that section.
Thank you. If the committee understands, we have a motion and a second to recommend adopting the substitute. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, substitute before, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, members, as you know, I don't serve on this committee. I'm not here very often. So some of this may be familiar to you. Some of it was not familiar to me. So I'm going to say a few things about how it operates today and then how my bill would change things. As you probably are aware, folks who win the lottery can have their first and last names, their hometown, and the amount that they have won publicized. This is done in part to forward the lottery's own achievements and its work on behalf of Virginians. But as you can imagine, with the kinds of lottery prizes that have come to be known, there are people who win these things and who are begin to experience a new part of life that doesn't simply include pleasures of winning that money. There are numerous winners of large lottery prizes that have been deluged with entreaties for donations, pummeled with potential scams, robbed, subjected to frivolous lawsuits, and threatened. In Georgia, 2 years ago, the winner of a relatively small prize, about $400,000, was shot to death in his home by thieves. Secondly, and more importantly, state lotteries participating in multi-prize games, Powerball, Mega Millions, have vastly increased the long odds of winning the top prize as a means of enlarging the top prize itself. You all will recall the $1.6 billion Mega Millions drawing recently. I won't ask how many participated in that, but many people did. And
I'm still here, by the way.
I suspect the lottery is listening, so. But a single winner won that. And when people win those kinds of things, people who have nefarious intent take notice. $1.6 billion, obviously, is rare. But even those who take a smaller amount, win a smaller amount, take the cash option, can be subject to serious threats and more serious problems. A gentleman in Virginia who won a top prize over the course of a decade moved five times to be able to protect his privacy and anonymity after having been publicized. There are numerous other things that have been suggested. One thing that's different about my bill and some of the others that you will see is it starts at a threshold of $10 million. Why did I choose that threshold? I chose that because that's the largest amount you can get on a scratch ticket. That's the biggest prize that's available. I thought that was a good threshold to start. I don't know that there's any magic in that number, but I thought that would be obvious that could be a problem for people. And about 56% of sales from lottery come from scratch tickets. I'm told, at least last I knew, Virginia Lottery said they did not have a position on the bill. The only opposition I've heard is from open government folks. And my own view is that the concerns of individuals that I've given some indications of, I think, transcend the open government challenges that I have heard. I think they are those kinds of threats and dangers are greater. So that, Mr. Chairman, is kind of a short version of what it does and why I have it.
Thank you. At this juncture, do we have any questions for the paper at this time?
I'm curious if you know, and you may not know, they may have to speak for themselves, but this was always a lottery sort of guarded this aspect of their prize promotion that they can announce a winner by hand. Is that something they no longer take an interest in, or they just drew up, they're comfortable with where you've drawn the line? I'm curious if you know.
I have not been communicated to by them, so I don't know. I have no way of knowing what their position may be on this.
Okay. I was under the impression they had not taken a position on this, but that's just maybe that you're not aware of a position or that they...
They have not informed me of their position.
Okay.
So and maybe that the threshold has moved it.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Okay. Other point?
Listen, I'm just curious why you set a threshold at 10 million.
The largest prize that you can get for a scratch-off ticket is $10 million in Virginia. And so I figured that was a place which allows the lottery still to publicize lesser amounts if they choose to, which I think promotion is certainly a legitimate and valuable thing. And there are other ancillary benefits
members of the subcommittee, Mark Hickman with Commonwealth Strategy Group. We represent the Virginia Press Association. And we do have concerns with the legislation, and they're simple. We believe an organization like the lottery, which sold more than $2 billion worth of tickets last year and awards millions of dollars every year, should be completely transparent in who wins the lottery. This is important for the integrity of and faith in the system. It's important that we are able to see that real people win. And in addition, only 7 states have laws that provide options for winners to remain anonymous throughout the country. So for those reasons, we oppose the bills in front of you today pertaining to this matter. We certainly do understand and appreciate the concerns and the intention of the delegate. We appreciate that the bill is narrowly drawn for those who win $10 million or more. If it were to advance, we would appreciate the opportunity to perhaps work with the delegate on making it an opt-out bill, meaning that the names and information of the winners are automatically disclosed unless they opt out. So be happy to express those concerns, and we appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the subcommittee. Mark is, I'm Megan Ryan with Virginia Coalition for Open Government, and Mark has mostly articulated our concerns as well. But I just wanted to point out that people announce their wealth in different ways, from the cars we drive and the houses that we live in, to the large donations that we make, to asking people to name buildings after us at universities. Some people appear on public, nationally televised game shows, and they win awards then. All of these people are different from the people we're talking about here, and that they are not receiving money from a government-run program. And a government-run program that needs to be accountable generally, just as all government-run programs do, but also specifically because it is a program that is built on a foundation of trust that the games that they are administering are fair and free of manipulation. I would like to also point out that reporters in Iowa, Wisconsin, and Florida used lottery data, which included the names of winners, to uncover collusion between lottery officials and straw buyers, as well as winners with close ties to and ownership of, in some cases, of the retail stores where the winning tickets were sold, as well as people who owed back child support and back taxes, essentially laundering money through the lottery by having other people cash their tickets for them. While I am sympathetic to the safety concerns of these individuals, the solution to me is to enforce the criminal laws against those people rather than to cut off this important avenue of public accountability. Thank you.
Okay. Committee, any other questions of anchor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And maybe this is a question that the patron doesn't know, but do we have any data on how many folks have won more than $10 million in Virginia in the last few years?
I have to think it's de minimis. If the lottery's here, I do not have that.
Kelly Jones, I can get the lottery up here if you want to talk about that.
I'm okay. Thank you.
We were kind of waiting for an initiation of the new person of the lottery.
Well, if the lottery doesn't have up here,
yeah,
I think
we're
up
right earlier. Oh, welcome, Kelly.
Hello, Mr. Chairman.
Did you hear the question?
Yes. The answer is, last year there were two, in calendar year 2018, there were 2 winners that won $10 million or more.
Delegate Gilbert, don't you have some questions?
So you tried to talk me out of finding a way to have you have to come do this. Now I'm interested if the lottery has a position, because I always understood the lottery had a position against any changes to the public disclosure. Can you represent that anyone has changed their mind about this, or?
No, historically the lottery has had concerns about proposals that would decrease transparency in our winner claims process. We've maintained that and believe that winner information only increases public confidence in the integrity of our games. We recognize with the record-breaking jackpots the concerns of the patrons, so we're neutral on the proposals.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I have a question for you. Winners throughout the lottery, say $5 million.
So many years ago in the 1930s, my grandfather, Angel Meares, won the lottery in Cuba. And we still talk about it 80 years later, the family in Miami. Obviously, Casher took it all eventually, but how it was one of the worst things that ever happened to him because everybody was asking to give him money. And as part of the, I guess, the Right to Be Left Alone Coalition, I think this is probably a pretty commendable bill, so I applaud you for bringing it.
And Delegate Ware, gentlemen, you sit in the back row with you and myself, Delegate Abbott, had some friends sitting in his driveway early one Saturday morning, and they had won a very large Virginia lottery, and they were extremely apprehensive, and they had to hire a lawyer and do what they could do and everything, and they kind of got a little hounded too. So that's a real world experience that Delegate Jordan is kind of looking forward to. So, any other discussion?
I would simply ratify that. Since I've put the bill in, which actually came out of conversations with constituents, I've had people come to me who've had that kind of apprehension, and in more than a few cases, more than apprehension.
Okay, committee, you need to report.
Second.
Okay, is there a motion and a second to report the discussion? All in favor, please cast your vote.
Similar things that Delegate Ware's bill was looking at, the exception being that it actually applies to all lottery winnings as opposed to just a $10 million threshold. And the other thing does is that in an effort to proactively address the concern about the fact of being able to put out the information both for marketing as well as for the purposes of transparency, what this does is this simply delays the notification of the individuals and who has been made the awardees by 1 year. So that way the information will still be available, but what this does is this gives those individuals an opportunity to be able to get legal and financial advice and hopefully to not have someone sitting there in their driveway immediately, but it will still be able to hold true to the ideals of the lottery so that the information can be published and they'll be able to use it for marketing to get additional people to actually buy the lottery tickets, but they will have a kind of a cooling off period for them to then be able to actually get legal and financial advice. And the way that this is set up is that it would be an opt-in option for the winner. So they would then be able to address the question that I think somebody else had asked that said, has anyone ever asked if they could be, if their information could be excluded? This would provide for that exclusion for a period of 1 year.
Okay, any questions or paper at this point? Okay, anyone here to speak in favor of this bill? Okay, anyone in opposition?
Mark Lippman with the Virginia Press Association. We oppose this bill for the reasons previously stated.
Okay. Megan, did you concur?
I concur with Mark, yes.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to hear from the lottery representative on this bill, please.
Okay. And Kelly, say your full name and title for us, please.
Kelly G. with the Virginia Lottery. So was there a question?
Yes, if you can give me your opinion, please, relative to this bill.
Sure. Delegate has previously stated that we believe that transparency is integral to the public's confidence in our games. When real people see that real people win, they can trust that the lottery is operating in an accountable manner. But we recognize the concerns with jackpots and all that, so we remain neutral on this proposal.
Is there a threshold that the lottery lottery uses to publicize winners? In other words, do you have a $100 line or a $1,000 line, or where you say so and so won $1,000 at the, you know, the Handy Mart in Strasbourg? I assume sometimes you publish those types of winners either online or in other publications. I was just wondering if there's some, if there's an amount that's low enough that you never bother to mention.
Yeah, so again, FOIA requires that we disclose the name, hometown, and amount won. If you're asking about press conferences.
Yeah, I'm more in terms of your promotion of winners, if you know. You may not know that side as well.
No, I don't know.
Okay.
A constituent concern as well, and then much like Delegate Ware's information, is that after this had come out, it then became one of those type of things where other individuals said that they thought that this was a good idea. Again, it provides this cooling off period for someone to be able to actually get the award, be able to kind of get their house in order, both financially and legally, before they get kind of bombarded with friends, neighbors, relatives, and all of those other individuals who might want to give them ideas about what to do with their winnings. And so that was the impetus behind it, and then it kind of grew from there. And again, taking into consideration, because I really do, I'm very much empathetic to what both the lottery said, as well as the press and the other ones, is that I think by having that 1 year time frame on there, that still allows them to be able to actually do all of those things that they want to do. And again, it just gives the winner the opportunity to have a little bit of time to be able to get things in order before they're faced with all of that scrutiny.
Mr. Chair, so my concern would be just, I mean, we just took a, from what I understand, there were two people that would have affected recently that had those big jackpots like that. Potentially, you're talking about tens of thousands of winning tickets, right? That would suddenly, instead of just taking a nibble out of this transparency issue because of the high amounts involved and the additional, exponentially more serious security risks and whatnot, we're now talking about tens of thousands of winning tickets potentially.
So that's a good point, and that's one of those things where, as I sat here and listened to Delta Ware, it's one of those things where I would be in favor of a friendly amendment to put a threshold on this of $1 million or $5 million, or use it in a line with what Delegate Ware has already had before.
Sure. Another
question for Paige. I've voiced the same concern as Delegate Gilbert. Where is the financial threshold? When does it start? Is there a certain level where it starts and then you have this waiting period? Does it start as a $1,000 awardee and it goes up, or where does it start?
Yeah, that's a good question, and the intent would be for it to apply to lottery winners, as in the Mega Millions, the Powerball, those type of things, not to just the routine ticket winners. And that.
For years and years, because they've always come here and told us that the winners are the very best advertising they could possibly get. So with this particular amount of advertising they can get, and knowing that typically the lottery has year over year gains, we typically make a little bit more money, and knowing that the lottery goes to the Literary Fund, which funds schools and helps pay school teachers, then this is a very, very earnings mechanism for the state. And some of us have said on appropriations, we're always looking for as much money. And we actually took some strings off of this chairman piece last year or two. So this money was more discretionary with no strings attached on it. So I personally would kind of can understand Delegate Ware's bill. But on this one here, I think we may be handicapping ourselves some, so that's just my commentary.
Can I respond to that?
Yes, sir.
I agree with you conceptually. It's just that I think after a period of time, you won't actually have any detrimental effect on the marketing side, because after you get past that first period where you're not, where you're basically holding the notification for a year, then it will just continue to roll on from that point forward. So you'll still have marketing. It just won't be the immediacy as it was at that particular point in time. And again, this is about being a way to provide those individuals who are winners of this life-changing amount of money an opportunity to kind of be able to get their legal and financial system in order before they're faced with all of that scrutiny.
Thank you. We understand that you're flagged time. Okay, committee, what's your pleasure? Okay, there's a motion to report and a second. Okay, I have a substitute motion which takes precedence. Lay the bill on the table. Do I have a second? Okay, there's a second to that. There's no discussion on that one. So we'll please cast your vote on the substitute motion, which is to lay the bill on the table, which, if you agree with that, would be a yes vote. Bill by a vote of 5-3 is laid on the table.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for me.
Thank you. Okay. I think that's all we've got. So the committee shall rise.
Or the stellar bill.